Do you wish you knew how to remember everything you hear? If so, you might feel like you're a poor listener because you forget so many details. Worse, you wind up losing out on so many opportunities to participate in the present conversation and take action based on what you hear in your conversations in the future. Let's say somebody mentions a book, and you know you just have to read that book because it's going to help you conquer an important goal. But after you leave your meeting, you not only forget what the book is called, you even forget that anyone mentioned the perfect path existed for you in the first place. Well, if that's ever happened to you, good news. There's a way to eliminate this problem from your life forever. And in this video, I'll show you how to remember all the important details in any conversation from now on. You're about to become a warrior of the mind who never forgets important details again. Let's get started. Hey there, this is Dr. Anthony Metivier from MagneticMerryMethod.com. I'm devoted to helping you remember all the critical details of every conversation you have for the rest of your life. So if you're new here, get subscribed, hit that thumbs up, and for the love of memory, let me give you the free course that has freed thousands of people around the world from tedious repetition and frightfully painful forgetting. But first, let me share with you what you need to do first in order to see any improvement in your memory for remembering everything you hear. Commit. I hope you can hear that. Commit. Now, I know, some people are already clicking the back button because some crazy teacher on the internet is trying to hold you accountable to your goals. But we all know it's true. Those who succeed at anything are committed to learning skills and practicing. And that's all that I ask in the conversation we're having now. It's a one-way conversation, but you can make it more engaging by getting involved in the discussion if you wish. Remember, the need to commit is what you need in order to improve your memory and everything in life. So with that in mind, here's what I want you to commit to first. The first thing you need to do is start becoming more aware of the details as they fly past your ears. Then you need to grab hold of them and pin them in place. To do this, you'll want to learn a special technique called the Memory Palace. Now, there are a few ways to use this technique for conversations, and we'll get into them. But the first thing to understand is that you can use rooms to place ideas that you want to memorize. For example, let's say the friends Janet and Tina are hanging out in a cafe. Janet tells Tina about a book that will help her improve her memory. The book is called The Victorious Mind by me, Anthony Metivier. To use a Memory Palace, Tina takes this difficult new title and connects it with information she already knows, something that sounds like Victorious Mind. She then mentally places the association that she came up with in the corner of the cafe. By focusing on a location in a room and placing an association, you have a reference point you can return to later. So let's say that Tina's a fan of the show Victor Frankenstein, and this book is by Anthony Metivier. So she imagines Victor handing his mind to an ant after a battle. He's feeling victorious when he does it. And now this association is not a one-to-one correspondence, but it's good enough. And later, when Tina searches for the book on Google, she's going to think back to the corner of that cafe and remember the key images she placed there. Victorious, mind, and Anthony, or at least ant, based on the associative imagery. These are the basics of the Memory Palace technique. And now that you know about using the space around you, such as corners, exaggerate and elaborate everything about the association that you just made. Instead of just having Victor Frankenstein hand his mind to an ant, imagine his mind exploding like a bomb. Make sure that you make your associations multi-sensory. Feel it explode. Really, really feel it. Taste the dust of the explosion in your mouth and smell the burning flames. That way, this is going to be even easier to remember later. Hearing that sound, feeling its force in your imagination makes it stickier, and it makes it stickier in that specific corner. So you could even imagine that corner being destroyed. This kind of elaborative encoding can feel difficult when you're new to using these techniques. But don't fret. These visualization exercises will help you develop the skills in no time at all. You really just have to think of what you want to memorize and start using those cafes and the corners in them. The trick, though, is to have a system for adding these exaggerations. And I use the Cave-Coggs formula. Kinesthetic, auditory, visual, emotional, conceptual, olfactory, gustatory, and spatial. And one way to practice running through each of those is to run through them while developing your first peg word system. So there's a video about this on this channel, and you're very welcome to watch it. By this point, you're probably thinking, Great. I know how to memorize just one detail from a conversation. What about the thousands of details I encounter in my conversations every week? Well, we all start somewhere. And if you can't memorize one detail, there's no point in worrying about how to memorize thousands of them, right? Scaling up to multiple details is easy, but you need the basics mastered first. Then, to scale is easy, provided you follow a simple recommendation. If you know how to turn any room into a memory palace with at least 8 magnetic stations in it, you can use a simple number system and you can turn any memory palace that will help you recall every detail in any conversation into a powerful tool that will serve you for the rest of your life in any room that you ever enter. And we call this in the Magnetic Memory Method world, the Magnetic Square. It's one of several different ways to use the Memory Palace technique, and I love it especially for cafe meetings because it makes it easy to turn any room into a powerful memory tool. You can also learn how to expand it into a magnetic cube, and if you'd like all the details for more variations on this, get the free course at magneticmemorymethod.com/YT. The point is to start somewhere and then build your skills consistently over time. Learn to memorize a few details from conversations, or even just one at first, and then build from there. And remember, you don't actually have to be in the room you're using to remember the details of any conversation. You can think about any building or location around the world. You just need to prepare the memory palaces you want to use first. Being prepared in advance is the key. And now that you know how to retain information when listening, let's give you some practice drills. When you're listening to Remember, using the news and podcasts makes for great practice. One is visual and audio, where the other is purely auditory. And when watching the news, you can use the screen as a memory palace to encode details as they emerge. You can even practice memorizing conversations in real time by turning your TV into a memory palace. Now, this is a small space, but it will allow you to memorize 4 details, and it will keep you focused on the practice. And if you get really good, you can learn ways to reuse that little TV as a memory palace. You can also use the body of the reporter to capture and pin details. So you could practice turning the body into a memory palace by using the news anchors themselves and then use the bodies of your friends or people at meetings to remember what they say during conversations. Then, when you're used to doing this with people on TV, you can transfer linking details to the bodies of people with whom you hold conversations or even think about that anchor on TV and use them while you're in a room with a person having a conversation. So it's very, very simple and fun. When it comes to podcasts, you could use your smartphone as a memory palace, or even try using other objects like a coin in your pocket, or you could even practice using playing cards while listening to podcasts, which I talked about in my video on my memory palace practice habits. So you have learned how to use rooms, objects like TVs, and human bodies to encode information that you hear during conversations. When it comes to retention, you'll want to do a small amount of repetition that fires off the cave cogs we talked about previously. For example, I recently met with a private coaching client named Michael. Within the first few minutes of speaking, Michael told me about a friend named Carrie, a math teacher named Igor. He talked about Naples, Harvard, studying for chemistry for a Regents exam, and upstate New York. Using the association technique you learned above, I proved to him that I was listening by reciting all those details back, and all I was doing was placing those details around the screen of my computer as we met on Skype. And then I quickly revisited each of them as I went through cave cogs. And so, to take just one example, he had a friend named Carrie, and I used cave cogs to associate that name with Carrie King, the guitarist in Slayer. I felt Carrie King's guitar as I was holding it myself. I heard a Slayer song, felt emotions associated with it, and so on. All within seconds, something you can learn to do too. Hearing music, feeling the sensation of the guitar, feeling emotions, it helps the memory stick very quickly. And you might think that it's a lot of heavy lifting to go through 8 magnetic modes so quickly, but with a small amount of practice, it's more than easy. It's incredibly fun. And if you really get into this, there are 20 more magnetic modes in the Magnetic Memory Method Masterclass. So if you want to hang on to information from conversations for the long haul, please make sure that you use the recall rehearsal patterns in combination with the magnetic modes as taught in the Magnetic Memory Method Masterclass. You'll also do very, very well to write down what you heard later and speak about the key details to verbalize the info in your own words for long-term retention. And do any follow-up reading and listen to any podcasts or videos that will deepen the information that came up in the conversation. this literally changed my life. I wrote an entire book called The Victorious Mind because I remembered using the memory palace, a book called Happiness Beyond Thought that a friend of mine named Ben mentioned to me. And because I was able to remember it, it changed my entire life. I even wound up giving a TEDx talk about what happened after I read Happiness Beyond Thought, something that would have been completely lost if I'd forgotten the title of that book. Now, I want you to understand something though. If you have to, there's nothing wrong with taking notes during conversations. Although I can memorize in real time and you can too, I still sometimes jot things down. In fact, it's hard to test if you were correct about certain details if you don't write the info down. For example, another friend of mine suggested that I visit Mount Nebo. Now, memorizing the name of this location was easy, but I wanted to make sure that what I memorized was accurate later, and we were in a noisy cafe, and I just wasn't sure that I'd heard the pronunciation correctly. So I asked him to spell it, and then I wrote it down. It's perfectly okay to take notes during conversations, and sometimes you just need to, especially when you have to make sure that pronunciations are correct. And in this case, I also wanted to be able to hand my notebook to my wife and have her enjoy the benefit of being able to follow up on multiple locations that were suggested. So that's just a little thing to think about, and you can practice and still write things down. They can go together. Now, sometimes people tell you things that involve the future, like something you want to look up or visit. And this taps into what scientists call prospective memory. And to remember future things, you have at least two options: a mnemonic calendar or spatial labeling. Using a mnemonic calendar involves learning the major system, and this helps you create images for every number. It's like the pegword method. For example, when I wanted to remember that my friend Nick's birthday is October 25th, I imagined a nail going through a pumpkin. Now, nail is the image for 25, and pumpkin is the image for October, but sometimes I use Niall Ferguson. When it comes to spatial labeling, I'll give you an example. As I was just telling you, my friend Ben told me the title of a book called Happiness Beyond Thought that I knew I absolutely needed to read. To protect my memory, I usually don't carry the internet with me, and for some reason I didn't have a notebook that day. So I not only remembered the title, but I remembered to order it when I got back home by placing an association of the image that reminded me of Happiness Beyond Thought at my desk. So the very act of going home reminded me to order it. And when I got home, I literally walked into a memory palace and was reminded to look that book up and order it. And it changed and improved everything. So this is worth doing. And you can do this spatial labeling for all kinds of things you need to remember, from groceries for a recipe that you need to pick up, to making a dentist appointment or memorizing your credit card so you don't have to pull it out every time you shop online. So if you're interested in that, I do have material already written about prospective memory that goes deeper into that. Let me know in the comments if you want to hear more about it. It's a science video about memory, and I don't do that many science things, but if there's enough demand and interest, I'll do it for you. Now, one last tip before we go, but first, a thank you to our channel members and everyone who has the Magnetic Memory Method Masterclass or who has supported this initiative in any way. You mean the world to me, and you make it all possible, and everyone on Team Magnetic appreciates it. And if you're new here and you want to be part of this mission, welcome. Hit that thumbs up, get subscribed, and you know, we might not be the most exciting memory channel on the planet, but I do strive to keep it real. And on that note, here's a frank and honest tip. I'm not sure anyone needs to remember everything. The trick is being able to remember the information that matters. Knowing exactly what that information might be is its own skill, and it involves developing pattern recognition and discernment. And being able to memorize will naturally guide you to developing these meta skills of pattern recognition and discernment. And that means the best time to get started with memory training was yesterday. The second best time is now. So how exactly do you get yourself started? Well, can you remember my opening tip? Let me help you out if not. It was to commit. So what do you say? Do you think you can commit? And are you ready to remember more from the conversations you hold? Get yourself some memory palaces created, learn to associate, and please keep the Magnetic Memory Method family posted on your progress along the way. And until next time, keep yourself magnetic.